What's up, guys? We're back with another funny podcast segment from Joe Rogan's podcast. And this one is called The Story of the Man. Sorry, guys. The Story of the Man Who Survived the Titanic by Being Drunk. Okay, so apparently if you drink alcohol and jump into freezing water, you know, you actually are able to survive longer. And it's actually a really good idea. I'll tell you guys what I would think of this, because I think it's a great idea. If I was going to be stuck in the water for a supposedly, you know, unknown length of time, I'm definitely going to drink and get really drunk, because alcohol can actually help you guys. And I'll tell you, the only times it helps you is when you want to forget about stuff, all right? If like it's a traumatic event, if you're going through something traumatic, if you're on a desert island about to die and you don't know if you're going to live, probably start drinking. Like, that's probably the only time I would do that. So this one's going to be incredible, guys. Let's get it.
The Joe Rogan Experience.
Do you know the one of the dudes that survived the Titanic? He was in the water for 2 hours. I think he was a chef. And the story was that he got drunk before he went in the water. He just got hammered because he knew he was going to die.
Yeah, because I would tread water for 2 hours, pretty much no problem. But even if you're on top of like a door, like in Titanic, the movie, you know, you have to be able to just kind of forget about the pain for a while, you know?
And somehow or another, because he was drunk, he survived. See if you can find that.
Got it.
I was reading this. I was like, how does that make sense? How a baker survived the Titanic sinking by getting really drunk.
It's unbelievable.
God damn it. I had blockers, these motherfuckers. There we go. Okay. So, can you go back up so I could read? Scroll. So, it says Charles, how do you say that? Johan? How do you say that?
Charles Johan. So, I mean, he could be, I think this guy sounds Irish, guys. But, you know, he's probably not. Johan sounds like German or something like that.
Johan was one of the disaster's most unlikely survivors, and he did it thanks to industrial amounts of liquor. So this dude got super duper hammered before he went in the water, and somehow or another it helped him survive. It was an almost physiologically impossible feat of survival. And according to the British Titanic Inquiry, it was because the 33-year-old Englishman had the presence of mind to greet history's greatest maritime disaster by getting smashed.
Yeah, like, the thing is, guys, that's a really great foresight, because you'd be able to survive it physically, probably. But mentally, you know, I would never want to go swimming drunk. That's probably not safe. But if you're going to be in the water for a long time, get that alcohol in you, guys. It'll keep your mind idle. You might be having good crack. You know what I mean? You'd be having good crack just there, like, oh yeah, like, what's the story, boys? You know what I mean? Do you want a pint? Do you want a drink? You know what I mean? But you'd be forgetting about the pain, you know?
So
he knew he was dying.
So he just decided to get fucked up, but he survived. In survival situations, having all that warm blood away from the vital organs means that the drinker is at a greater risk of hypothermia. Huh. However, Canadian hypothermia expert Gordon Geisbrecht figures in the minus 2 degrees Celsius temperature of the North Atlantic, the water was cold enough to quickly tighten Johan's blood vessels and cancel out any effects of the alcohol. So then, at a low to moderate doses of alcohol, cold will win out, says...
At a low to moderate dose of alcohol, cold will win out, said Geisbrecht.
Geisbrecht, a University of Manitoba professor, has performed hundreds of cold water immersion studies. What Johan would have had, however, is the awesome life-saving power of liquid courage.
Exactly, guys. It will stop you from going into shock. That will be my whole thing. I'm like, let's just get hammered before this thing collapses, because we need to be in here for a long time. So if you can just mentally prepare yourself for that.
Alcohol remains a leading cause of humans getting into fatal situations, including freezing to death. Nevertheless, the relaxing qualities of the drug have long been known to give humans an uncanny ability to survive trauma.
Told you.
This reminded me of the story, the lady that passed out in the snow, and her friends found her like the next day,
mm-hmm.
and they brought her in, she was still alive.
Yeah, they're saying right here, in the ER, cold patients who are really drunk can walk in and they're conscious at a temperature that they shouldn't be.
So that's what I'm saying, guys. Like, you need to be able to withstand the mental fortitude of it. You know, if you're physically in pain, I'm dying in the cold. Yeah, you're screwed, guys. If you can just forget about it by getting drunk.
Being drunk keeps you alive. Keep scrolling down a little more.
That's it?
That's it?
Yeah.
No. Yeah. His actions might speak to a man unfazed by impending disaster. Immediately upon hearing the collision with an iceberg, the chief baker leapt out of his bunk and began dispatching his staff to stock the lifeboats with bread and biscuits. This done, he popped back into his cabin for a drink before heading topside to help load lifeboats. Not only did Joaquin, however I say his name, Joaquin, refuse his own place on a boat, but there's no men like that today. But he and a few other men began forcibly chucking reluctant women into empty seats, likely saving their lives. He said, "We threw them in," he testified later. Top deck of the increasingly listing Titanic was mostly cleared of lifeboats by 1:30 a.m. To most, this was a panic-inducing sign that all hopes of rescue was gone, but to whatever his name is, it was a cue to head back to his cabin for another drink. So this dude's just getting fucked up. He sat down on his bunk and nursed it along, aware but not particularly caring that the water now rippled through the cabin doorway, wrote historian Walter Lord in A Night to Remember. Lord was in touch with the dude before the baker's 1956 death. He said the dude then splashed topside again, where he took upon himself to begin throwing deck chairs overboard with an eye to filling the water with impromptu flotation devices. So the people
could... Oh, so he was throwing stuff overboard so he could float on it? Dude, who is this Navy SEAL survival expert, Joaquin?
Float around on the chairs. His perch, he then worked his way back to the pantry to get a drink of water. The baker was standing on the stern when the ship broke in half. And yet he remembered the violent, catastrophic breakup only as a great list over to port. There was no great shock or anything, he told the Inquirer. So he was just hammered. Deftly moving through the swarms of people, he made it to the stern rail of the ship. Exactly 2:20 a.m., he rode the sinking Titanic into the sea like an elevator. Whoa,
that's insane. Because I would jump away from the boat and swim away. That's one thing in the movies, how they ride it into the water. I would not do that because I would be afraid that the momentum of the water or something like that would pull me down with the boat. I'd always, you know, whenever I was swimming a lot, I would always stay away from big boats and these things because a lot of the times the swells can drag you under, you know.
As with all surviving Titanic crew members, 2:20 a.m. on April 15, 1912 was also the exact moment in which the White Star Line stopped paying him. Oh boy. The first stage of cold water immersion is known as cold shock. Horrifying sensation of having the skin cool. The feelings with the Titanic second officer, Charles Lightoller, described as being like...
All their names are just insane, bro.
Like 1,000 knives being driven into one's body. So this, how did this dude survive? What did he float around on for 2 hours?
Chair, probably.
Did it say?
Paddling and treading water, he said.
I was just paddling and treading water for 2 hours?
What? I mean, an hour is long. I used to, when I was my peak swimming fitness, I would paddle water for like an hour. You know, 45 minutes to an hour. I remember that. And I mean, I remember trying to like work out by doing that. And it wasn't that bad. You know, I was an experienced swimmer at the time, but now I couldn't do that. So 2 hours is tough, bro.
Oh, my God.
That's...
How come Leo couldn't do that then in the movie? He just sunk in the water after 2 minutes.
But this Leo wasn't hammered, and he gave up. This dude didn't give up.
Yeah.
He paddled water for hours. I guess it took a couple of hours for them to get someone to get to them.
Jesus. Yeah, after 2 hours.
Which is pretty impressive that they got to them in 2 hours.
Yeah. That's fast because it was in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, like.
Eventually, hold.
In 19 what? What was this like?
19 or somewhere around there.
1901.
The exact 1912.
12. The early 1900s. So the fact they got to them in 2 hours is pretty amazing. 1919.
Yeah, that's.
Oh no, 107th anniversary. Yeah. Okay. So.
12.
Yeah, 1912. Wow.
Dude, that's an amazing story. Wow, I like that. That's an unexpected story that I wasn't expecting to hear to be very impressive. You can always rely on us Brits to apply alcohol as a solution to any life-threatening situation. It's funny, you know, because I suppose, like, you'd think that the guy's British. I said he's probably Irish, to be honest. But I suppose, like, you know, you'd probably think that over time that 2 hours, even being drunk, to swim drunk for 2 hours is tough. But to swim drunk is just, That's in itself a feat, so unbelievable. I visited the man's grave in Paterson, New Jersey. Left him a handle. He was truly a hero that night. He heaved over 50 lounges off the deck as flotation advices. A first officer actually put him in a lifeboat, but he gave up his seat to a woman and child. Well, wow. No men like that left in the world, guys. How many brave men are like that left in the world? I love you guys all. I'll see you all in the next one. Peace.